Hello and welcome to Mindscapes, our series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision and philosophy define our contemporary world. That introduction perhaps should be refined to say, for our guest today, a philosophy that will not just define our contemporary world, but generations to come. He's a national treasure, an icon, who embodies the highest aspiration of an ancient tradition. I'm delighted to welcome Yogacharya B.K.S. Iyengar. You honor us by being here. Guruji, if I may call you that. When does exercise or posture become yoga?
In the beginning, when we start, we work from the cognitive action, peripheral body. And that's why it acts as an exercise, because we have to tone the external body before the external body reaches the inner body. Whatever we do today, the mind is always on the surface of the outer body. The mind is not at all close to the inner body. So when we start practicing in the beginning, it's a cognitive action. So it is a physical exercise at that moment. Then after acquiring a little control, then the teacher of yoga makes a person to cognize, to perceive what he's actually doing. So the moment he starts perceiving, then our senses of perception are introverted at that moment. Though we do not say this is a meditation, but we guide them how to see or how to introvert their senses of perception towards their mind, which is not visible at all.
In the yoga tradition,
yes,
you have meditation, you have pratyahara, you have different levels of this. What is the relationship between mind and body here?
Yes.
In terms of being mindful, yes, of posture, yes, of what is happening to, yes, the muscles, yes, and processes,
correct,
that you mentioned, and then going into the formal structured processes,
correct,
of meditation.
Correct. That's what I was explaining to you. When cognitive action is made to see inside, then the mind starts working. The mind is brought to action then, not before. When the mind comes in contact with the motor nerves or the sensory nerves or the organs of action and the senses of perception, the mind calls the intelligence, something is telling, but I cannot guide this part. Will you come and help me? So the intelligence, which has got the discriminative power, this parichaya avastha in yoga it is called, introducing the intelligence to various parts of the body. I am receiving some message, please go and guide. I am receiving the message, please go and guide. So this way it guides. When that is guided, when the intelligence moving along with the posture, reaching each and every pore of the skin of the body, that is known as, according to Hatha Yoga Pradipika, even it is called as Nishpatti Avastha, that is known as a meditative pose. You have reached the meditative pose at that time. And that becomes the real yogic asana. Till then, it is not yogasana.
You've mentioned teacher and the role of the yoga teacher.
Yes.
You are a great master.
I don't know.
Well, the sort of the community, the world in a sense, acknowledges you as being the preeminent yoga teacher and the master of our times. Very often, we see books of yoga, we see you performing the most intricate, yes, complex yogic postures, which feel and seem something that we can never attain. So, you know, often we just give up with a feeling of hopelessness and say, well, I'm never going to be able to do something that complex. When do the benefits of yoga begin to accrue? I mean, is it when we've spent half a lifetime mastering that complexity?
No, it was like that because, as I told you before, I had to work on my own. Now I removed all the weeds which come in the way. So I think today in the world, I can present you about nearly 200 to 300 pupils of mine who do like me. But though the elegance has not come in the presentation, they have not got the elegance. Because I can move the skin, I can show how the energy moves. One can see, cognize when I'm doing it. When others do it, it cannot be cognized.
But an average lay person like me,
yes,
with my sort of aches what hope do I have?
No, what happened was, life of Patanjali. Once Patanjali wanted to explain to 1,000 people about yoga. So he said, this is a story which I am giving you, a true story. And he said, I will teach all of you, behind the screen, nobody should open. And those who open will perish. All will perish. So the yoga, we say, is a peaceful. But Patanjali himself has written, gave this order. And one man did not come one day. And on the same day, one person, in a curiosity, just moved the screen to see how he can bring the people sitting behind the screen this attention. So the moment he opened the screen, all 999 people perished. And this one man came and apologized. He was very wild, but he said, at least one man is survived. All right. He was a yoga prasad. Later he said, you continue. Then he blessed him. Then I thought, he has got 1,000 heads. We say, sasashirshapu. So I thought, if Patanjali has got 1,000 heads, I got only one head, can I move the body in 1,000 ways? That's why I started, creating myself to do. And Gita was my help at that moment. When Lord Krishna, when Arjuna wanted Lord Krishna to show his appearance in physical form, he said, he could not see. He said, give me Divya Chakshu, divine eyes, so that I can see you. And he could not see his Virat Rupa. So Vishwarupa Darshana gave me a clue that Atma in our body is one. But in what shapes it can come without contorting the peripheral body? I should not contract, I should not throw away, but keeping in contact with the core. How Virat Purusha can be in different positions. So I started creating here and there, and I mastered it, sir.
And so that, in a sense, has become IYENGAR yoga.
Yoga, yes.
A very special
it,
form
it
of development
up like this, correct.
To that. Yoga is seen as this sort of synthesis between mind and body.
Correct.
Where does divinity come into it?
Now, this is a very interesting thing, because divinity comes when the chitta vritti is in a state of tatastata. There should be no movement at all. I can remain in a thoughtful, thoughtless state. When, as I told you before, that five methods of practices, from cognitive action, we have to go across the intellectual action. When intellectual action covers the entire body, the physical body does not come to the surface at all. It's only intelligence. Even I can tell you exactly whether my energy has moved on the inner nail of the big toe or not when I'm doing the poses. So I have to bring the energy. So when I bring the energy, the core has to move with it, Atma has to move with it. So as the intelligence covers the entire body, at that moment, I let my Atma also to cover the body. Like water takes shapes of different jars. So these poses are like different jars, but the content has to be fitting exactly into that jar or into that asana. That is how I learned and presented it.
In your teaching, the yama and the niyama,
yes,
the sort of do's and
yes,
the don'ts, are very critical,
yes,
very crucial, because it could otherwise lead to a glorification of,
correct,
the body.
Yes.
And the body is not merely an instrument. To what degree is a teacher?
This is very interesting, because when I teach asana, see, we do, like, because having gone into life of Mahatma Gandhi, Jay Prakash Narayan, Jay Krishnamurti and all, I thought of getting some ideas on my own. When we speak of ahimsa, I said, Mahatma Gandhiji, everybody say he's a non-violinist, but was he not violinist on his body? He fasted for 22 days. Did he not murder his cells into the body? So the violence was in him. But for others, the violence was not shown. The others thought he's a non-violent man. But for himself, he was thoroughly violent. So these ways I started studying lives of the people. And then I thought, when I'm doing Trikonasana or even Tadasana, if my right leg is working, if the right leg is just nagging, that means the active cells in the leg on the right is very powerful, draws the energy. And because the left leg is not bearing the weight, so it is non-violent, it's no action. So here, unconsciously, I'm dying, making the cells to die. Here, I'm overacting for the cells to dry. So that means I'm killing both ways. So this is how I started learning and started teaching. Now, as you said, when we do satya, this is ahimsa. Satya, what is the truth? When you stretch your right hand, when you do not stretch the left hand, your mind wanders. Suppose you connect the thumb or the middle finger of the right to the middle finger of the left as one single thread, then there is no movement at all. That is satya. And that they say, as that is one action, there is no greed. So conquest of greed comes in asanas, mental greed. And emotional greed, intellectual greed, comes to a standstill. And that only one can experience when I am teaching. But logically, it's very difficult for me to experience.
Bhakti has been a part of your life, too. Yes, you're a bhakt of Hanumanji. And I have to say that I've had the privilege of seeing you for several decades, and there has been a change in your physiognomy. I don't know if other people have told you this, from your devotion to Hanumanji. In what ways does bhakti reconcile with the practice of yoga, which is looking at mastery of the body and through the body an insight into the divine?
Sir, that was my adage which I've said. Asana is my prayer, and my body is the temple, and sanctum sanctorum is inside the heart. So when I'm starting asanas, it is for me like a japa. Patanjali also has given japa yoga. Tasya vachaka pranavaha tadjapaha tadartha bhavanam. He starts with bhakti yoga, then goes to jnana yoga, then karma yoga, then reaches by these three what Kaivalya means, what Moksha means. So this is why there are four chapters in Patanjali Yoga Sutra. So when he speaks of the word, tasya vachaka pranava tad japas tadartha bhavanam, my, for me, asana is a japa. But when I am doing the asana, if I don't understand the meaning and the feeling of that asana, it's not an asana at all. Then it's an exercise. So this Patanjali's quotation of japa artha with bhavana made me to think that why should I not think? If you say Om Namo Narayanaya, why should I not Om Namo Shirshasanaya Maha, Om Sarvangasanaya Maha, Om Halasanaya Maha, Om? Like that I can go on. So I thought that God is existing everywhere. He is also in this alphabet. So let me take that alphabet, asana, literally, its meaning, and let me feel and drink the meaning of that word, so that the japa, the artha, and the bhavana become one, and that is where the devotion comes, and that is the bhakti, when we reach that level, sir. That feeling, bhavana.
Is there something like a secular yoga that is possible?
My friend, yoga is secular. Even if it's a wrong word to be used these days. I said it is universal, not secular. Humanity is universal. So is there a secular human being or a universal human being? So universality has misunderstood as secular. But in 2500 DC ago, Patanjali says, yoga is a sarvabhauma, a universal bhumi. So that itself is enough for me to tell you that whatever the vocabularies one use, Patanjali has used, it is open to one and all.
But even the highest aspirations of yoga are accessible regardless of faith or lack of it.
Lack of it, no chance. Lack of it, no chance. Because that is why he says, what is Shraddha? Patanjali has explained. Something has to reveal in you. Till it is revealed, don't have faith. A man of his caliber, when he says, when once revelation has taken place, you need not be, I did not ask you to practice. Because the revelation has come, so the practice begins from that on.
What becomes the long-term cyclical goal, as it were, of yoga? What is the long-term goal of this, the striving of yoga? I mean, after all, we go through reincarnations, we go through several lifetimes. The body is an instrument for this lifetime.
Yes.
So in those cosmic terms,
yes,
what is the aspiration of yoga?
The aspiration of yoga, very well he has said in the second chapter, Vishesha. He has devised Vishesha, Avishesha, Linga, Alinga, Prakriti and Purusha. These are the divisions Patanjali has made. So the aspiration of the human being in the practice of yoga is Vishesha, means the Karmendriyas, Panchabhutas and Manas. These are visible to a human being, so it is Vishesha. And Avishesha is the Tanmatra, the Shabda, Sparsha, Rupa, Rasagandha and Ahankara. These are not visible, so these six or the avishesha, which cannot be cognized by the person. And this vishesha and avishesha are united together by the practice of yoga, asana, pranayama and dhyana. They lose their identities. When they lose their identities, only linga matra, what we call cosmic intelligence. Only cosmic intelligence as linga remains. And that linga also has to dissolve into the mula prakriti. So when mula prakriti is completely dissolved, then Purusha shines on his own. Till then, there is no self-realization. The self-realization comes only when prakriti is subsided, and that is the end of the asana, that is the end of the pranayama, that is the end of dhyana.
And then what happens at the time of death? It is this cosmic intelligence.
It is the cosmic intelligence which spreads. Recently, I have written an article, cosmic intelligence towards individual intelligence, from individual towards the cosmic intelligence. This is the life of yoga.
So how does a yogi approach death?
With a peaceful, happy mind. He doesn't think of death, sir. This is very interesting, because even I am also now 83, 84. It has not struck me, my age has not struck me even today. Only when people say you're 83, oh, I say. But I'm practicing still. So what I was practicing when I was 20, I'm still practicing. So the life of the cells have not deteriorated, but chronological life from my birth to my present day is 84 years. But biologically, I don't think I'm old. And that's why death is a biological action. So naturally, the biological, which is a natural process, so natural death is accepted by a yogi without fear complexes.
So how does a yogi approach death?
Well, Patanjali explains that, but I have not experienced that. So how can I talk about that? But I'm sure, like Lord Krishna says, that a yogi takes a birth in a rich man's house or in a poor yogi's house. And from that also I learned, I have not left off practice. What made me to come to this level, I am paying my respect to that art. That's why I am still practicing. So I don't want to become a yoga brahman, because I have seen lots of yogis in my life, I have seen lots of philosophers in my life. Then I thought I should also learn from saying what they do should not, they have done, I should not do. And that's why I have tremendous contentment, because I have done my job, now I should not be in the limelight. I have come with force to Delhi, as I told you. So this contentment which I am having now is not a, what you call pleasure contentment. It is a contentment which says, every now and then, my Atma says, you have done the job, now think of me. It comes from within. My core says, look at me. Why do you run your mind there and there? So I am more inside than outside. And I am practicing this for the simple reason that I may be born again if I have not completed the art. Let God give me a life in a poor man's yogi than in a rich man's house, because I may get tempted in a rich man's house. But I am practicing this just to be born again, if I have to be reborn in a poor yogi's house.
You are well-known, famous. Your school of yoga, the style of yoga, is taught in thousands of institutions around the world. And in India, it's really been available in Pune, and very recently, we hope it will be available in Delhi. Do you regret the fact that this tradition that you have created is not more widely available, practiced in the very land of its birth?
Well, sir, I don't regret, because for the simple reason, when I started yoga in 1934, when I came to Pune also in 1936-37, there were only 10 yogis or 12 yogis in the whole of India when India was not divided. That means even it had lost the fragrance of yoga in our own motherland. That's what made me to work hard and how to attract people by presenting this. Well, I could not speak at that time, sit for dhyana and all. Today people are taking. But I said, how to attract these people towards yoga? How to make yoga popular and educative and interesting. So I should use the body as an agent for them to change their attitude slowly. And I started building a philosophy while teaching asanas in what way they have to behave. So behavioral pattern I started building up in their practices of asanas. And I don't regret for the simple reason today, millions and millions are practicing.
More globally than locally.
Globally, local. Yes, that is true. But I think I'm also happy now locally also, it has been triggered. Now I'm happy. I have come to Delhi several times. I've given performances from 1970 in Delhi, not today. But there was no light, you know, it was only in dark. Every time the matchstick of yoga, whenever it used to strike, it used to go off.
It's interesting you call it matchstick because your seminal work is light on yoga.
Yes.
And you've used the word art, and you've used the word performance to describe yoga. And that gives it a dimension beyond the purely mechanical you have been talking about. When does it become art, as you said?
It's a divine art, sir. That's what I said. When? What Patanjali, I think I should quote again, Rupa Lavanya Bala Vajja Sammanatu Karya Sampate, Kaya Sampate. This is third chapter. He speaks of Ashtasiddhis. In that Ashtasiddhi, it comes there. He says, Rupa Lavanya Bala Vajra Sammanatvane. Compactness of the body is the wealth of the human being. The form, the elegance, Lakshana. So I took these words and I said, as a dancer presents, can we not present yoga in that artistic style? So also it is a lesson. For example, a musician knows exactly in a certain concert hall which raga only fits, rebounds in that hall. He does not play other ragas, as far as I know, all these great musicians in the world. So even they used to say, if somebody want to go, don't play that there because you'll be failure. Play this raga, you'll be successful. So when such things were there, then I started learning that when I'm presenting the poses, sometimes there was no response from the audience. Then I was not knowing what to do. Why such a difficult pose I am presenting? Then I started changing the angles. So when I started changing the angles, they could see. Then the clap started. Then when I was only 20 years, 25, I'm speaking of that. So when they started clasping, then I thought, oh, this is the way if I present, it will attract people. So that is how I started learning in what way the asana is presented on the platform, it attracts the people. And that's how
In what waves has the discoveries, the insights of modern science affected the practice and the understanding of yoga? From the time of Patanjali, we have had far more empirical tools. You've talked about different muscles that cardiologists and physicians learn. We now have a whole theory of the biochemistry of the brain, where you put in certain chemicals and you change thought. What has been that relationship?
No, now, for example, if you ask me, we call Ida Nadi, Pingala Nadi, Sushumna Nadi. Ida Nadi, they say, starts from the brain, and Pingala Nadi starts from the navel. So what is the present modern science says? Solar plexus and lunar plexus. Hypothalamus is considered as the lunar plexus, which keeps the body cool. And solar plexus creates heat. So nutrition of these two is Sushumna. So we can combine the old science with the modern science. That even in olden days, they were not speaking the body in the name of the muscles, but how to use the senses of person, organs of action to coordinate. In one language they used to say, for example, even if you read Gita, tasmatvam indriyanyado niyamya paratashabha. What are those indriyas? He has not said only five karmendriyas, five ganendriyas. He has spoken all the indriyas of the body. So these are the ideas we started giving me, that it is possible to connect the modern science with the old science. For example, another example, Bhishma had a cardiac attack. He could not turn this way or that way. So he asks Arjuna, I'm feeling thirsty. I can't sit, I can't turn. So please put an arrow so that the water comes and falls into my mouth. You must have read in the Mahabharata. That means he could not turn, he could not turn left or right, sit. So this is the symptoms of the cardiac disease of today. And he was on Sharapanjara. Why is the Sharap arrows, he slept on the arrows? So according to modern terminology, I have to think how we can combine together, coordinate together. Then I thought, the arrows are very sharp. So they were piercing his ventricles when he was lying down. And that was supplying the blood for their body because it was clear, cleansing. Then I thought, he slept on Sharapanjara, why should I not think of how Sharapanjarasana was done? And we say yogis were doing asanas on the trees. Then I started, where are the trees now in cities? Of course, Delhi is fortunate that we have got plenty of trees. But in Bombay, you can see it's a concrete jungle. Then I thought, can I make it like a branch rope? I used to tie ropes and I behave like a swinging, like children playing. So I started swinging in different poses and created...
In fact, one of the major sort of contributions of the IYENGAR school of yoga has in fact been the use of props and others, the things that you
can work
with.
So today ICU has come. What is ICU?
Intensive care unit.
Intensive care. So what these props are meant, I've sent, so that they control the movement of the blood, the movement of the breath, so that there is no injury at all. So they monitor the pose, these props. Because even old people, without fear, they can, even if you ask me, the Prime Minister yesterday said, I can't do it, but I can make him do. But if he makes up his mind, not that I can. So these props, I can't make him to stand because he can't even stand. But I can make him to stretch his leg with the help of the props.
What does a great living master who has embodied the highest aspirations of yoga already,
yes,
what more does he aspire to?
I don't think there is any aspiration, sir, no. I had the aspiration in the early days that I wanted to make yoga to become a known subject. So that's why my mission is, I think, almost has come to an end now.
Well, thank you very much. This has been a great blessing. And may we wish the biological body a long run. Yeah.